discussion is only going to focus on the semi-case graphical organizer assignment. We're going to be going over it. It's going to take a little while to do, but this is designed to be a help for you not only in your upcoming assignment, which you'll have to do something very similar to this, but also in your career, whenever you're required to take a large body of results from different evaluative sources and then try to culminate them into one cohesive diagnostic statement. All right, now, a little note on how I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this in the manner in which it was listed on the actual assignment document. Okay, so I'm not going to try to fill up each space as it goes along in our organizer. I'm going to work on it as it was mentioned. So if the audiologist was mentioned before the LD specialist, then we'll talk about the audiologist. All right, that's how this is going to be organized. All right. So these were the tests which we administered, the ones that I asked you all to select and administer to Latrice. Okay, we have the Peabody Picture Vocabulary Test, self-formulated sentences, recalling sentences, following directions, a phonological awareness subtest, and then the EOW-PBT. Now, these are very similar to the previous assignment which we did, other than we added the phonological awareness subtest to this. So all this could be done within the span of about an hour, all right? So this was just the first step. I gave you this one. I think it's pretty self-explanatory what the Peabody's assessing anyway. If you don't recall the nature of the task, it's you have a matrix of four different pictures, and the individual is asked to point to the and insert noun or verb or whatever, and they point to the picture that corresponds with whatever it is that you said. Okay, so that's what this task entails. And that one goes under receptive semantics. So remember that semantics is going to be pretty much synonymous with vocabulary. All right. Now, we'll try to mention scores whenever we can along here, especially looking at the scales of them and what it was that Latrice actually got. On this one, she got a 66 of a standard score of 66. So remember that a standard score has a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. That gives it an average range of 85 to 115. All right. Now, some places in which you work will actually require you to quantify how far something is below average based upon the units of standard deviation. So I wanted to talk a little moment about how you would do that one. All right. So if we wanted to determine how far below the mean score is, actually, we could list the number of points. All right, she had 66, so that's 44 points. What we could also do is talk about it in terms of the standard deviation. In order to do that, we would subtract the client score from the average score. Right? The average score is 100. We would subtract 66. We would wind up with 34. Then you would actually divide that number by the standard deviation, which once again was 15. So that would actually give us around 2.3 standard deviations below the mean. So Latrice's vocabulary score was 2.3 standard deviations below the mean. Okay, that's just a way in which we can somewhat standardize our means of talking about severity levels. All right. The next one that we had up there was the self-formulated sentences subtest. This is assessing an individual's ability to formulate semantically and grammatically correct spoken sentences using a given word. Sometimes we luck out and the test description actually gives us a pretty accurate description in which we can go straight through, and it really guides our ability to formulate and produce this graphic organizer or whatever graphic organizer that you may develop on your own. This is one of those situations, okay? And it is accurate too. So it's not just that it actually went through the process of naming it. It names it, and I would agree with its naming as well. Okay, so if we read this one, we see at least two obvious places where we need to put it. We need to put it in semantics and syntax. And also we see that word formulate there, so we know it's going to be in the expressive realm. But remember that whenever we do something like that, when we're making things more syntactically complex, we're going to tend to have an accompanying morphological change to go along with it as well. So we put that actually in all three of those there. All right, this one was a scaled score. So if you remember, the scaled score was an average of 10 plus or minus 3. So the range is 7 to 13. And Latrice actually obtained a scaled score of 4 on this one. So in that situation, she was well below the mean. All right. Okay. Next was the recalling sentences subtest, which just assesses an individual's ability to listen to and repeat sentences of increasing length and complexity. All right, so what I have underlined in this part is actually probably a little bit confusing to you. So you're talking about listen to, well, that sounds receptive. You talk about point to, that sounds a little, or repeat, and that sounds a little bit more expressive. Okay, most people are going to count this as an expressive test, and I wouldn't necessarily argue with that individual. However, I think that the more preeminent ability which is required of this one is the listening to portion, okay? So I would kind of put it a little bit more toward the receptive one, but understand where it's coming from. And I do want to remain consistent with what the test makers consider it. Who am I compared to the titans of speech language pathology who developed the self? But I do want you to keep in mind that like this is not perhaps your best measure of expressive syntax and morphology, because we're talking about increasing length and complexity. So we're looking at basically syntax and morphology. Now, one thing that some individuals might argue that I would not allow them to argue or would not agree with them when they were arguing about is that it's a measure of semantics as well. Well, you can increase it in terms of level of complexity in regards to semantics. In that situation, I wouldn't agree with that one, because once again, we're repeating sentences. Right? It doesn't have to have any meaning whatsoever for them to parrot it back to you. Right? So, here's where I would place these scores. So I actually put them underneath the expressive syntax and morphology categories. Once again, that little caveat of I think it's as heavily reliant upon receptive as it is expressive, if not more. Okay, so I did want to take a couple little excursions every once in a while and talk about what we do after we find this. This is just bringing back some old slides, some blasts from the past, and we talked about what we do when we find these expressive syntax and morphological scores. Okay, we talked about how it's difficult to kind of assess that given the nature of what it is. So we recommended doing actually some spontaneous speech samples, all right? So the recommendation in that situation is if they're MLU, once we did the spontaneous speech sample, their MLU, specifically their adapted MLU, was less than 4.5, we would analyze it in depth by looking at errors, complex sentences, and disruptions, okay? And if you refer back to the second section, you can see a lot more detail on how we can do those three things as well. All right, so back to our assessment at hand. All right, we have the following direction subtest, which assesses an individual's ability to follow spoken directions of increasing length and complexity. All right, so the follow is the key on this one if we're trying to determine whether or not it's receptive versus expressive. And that's what we're looking at here. It's not as explicit in this situation when you talk about increasing length and complexity. But if you do look at the test, which I would recommend that you do whenever you're trying to determine what these things are, not just solely relying upon the description that's given by the test makers, but if you do look at the test, you would see that it's increasing in terms of complexity in regards to semantic syntax and morphology. So we have this as being a receptive skill. A receptive skill. And it's going to fall under the category of semantic syntax and morphology in that situation. So, what score did she get on this one? It was once again below average, so she got a 3 on this one. This was actually very, very low. So, if she got a 3, and the scaled score average is, or the scaled score mean, is a 10, so we're 7 below that mean, with a standard deviation of 3. So, we're over 2 standard deviations below the mean in that situation. So, we're getting us some pretty severe deficits for Latrice, okay? So, I can just like slightly disappear in the middle of my screen. So they changed the setting in here to where I only get less screen to walk on, so I have to be more still. Sorry, you don't really care, do you? All right, the next one was the phonological awareness, so we've actually switched graphic organizers and looked at the other one here. So if you're following along at home, which why wouldn't you be? You're watching this. If you're following along at home, you would see that you need to pick up the other graphic organizer. And this is where we fill it in, okay? It's pretty self-explanatory where phonological awareness goes, especially on your graph, because everything else is blacked out around the phonological awareness. But that's because it's only an oral language skill, all right? There is no silent phonological awareness measure, and there's no written phonological awareness measure as far as I'm concerned. So it's an oral ability, so it's only got one place to go, and that would be there, okay? This is a criterion-based score, so what do I mean on this one? You're usually getting like an accuracy percentage out of this one, so they got to get a certain amount correct out of a certain amount of trials. She did not reach her criterion on this one, so she did poorly on it. So we put it there with another miser. Okay, and then the last one which we did with her, that we did, was looking at the EOW PBT. So this is just looking at expressive vocabulary. We give them a word, they give us, or we give them a description, they name it, or they describe some pictures of objects or actions. Kind of depends on where you are in the test. All right, so expressive semantics. This one was, once again, below average. We're looking at 64 of this one. So we would include that in our expressive semantics section. All right, so that kind of ends the test which we gave. It couldn't get much simpler than this, and it rarely does get this simple. She's just not doing well on anything, so pretty much everything that we're putting up there is going to have a minus sign behind it. We don't have any contradictory findings yet, so we haven't found a positive and a negative in, say, expressive semantics or something like that. And those are the ones that make it a little bit more difficult to comprehend. All right, now we're going to start adding in some other professionals' reports into this one, and that's where it can actually start to get a little bit more complicated and a little bit more difficult to interpret. A lot of times it's going to be somewhat of a situation where we're comparing apples to oranges, so I have to make some adjustments for that as well. All right, the audiologist report indicated a number of potential problems with auditory processing, so we'll keep that in mind in our recommendation section, meaning we'll most likely repeat the same recommendations to a degree to give preferential seating and amplification. We'll talk a little bit more in depth about Dr. Sanchez, the audiologist, recommendations coming up. Okay, so, well, actually, we'll talk about it now. If you read her recommendations, they actually extend beyond what you would expect an audiologist to recommend based on the testing in which she did. Okay, she did an awful lot of auditory processing testing. All right, so she's looking at listening to sounds and noise, listening to competing words, listening to, and it's just listening, basically assessing binaural integration, listening effort, and various skills that kind of fall under that auditory processing umbrella. All right, but actually some of the recommendations which she made, which I don't think she has any basis in order to make, is that she recommended reading aloud daily with an emphasis on animation to rhythm, stress, and intonation in expressive language. Okay, might that be a good idea? Yes, but there's nothing within her test results that would demonstrate that that would be a better thing for her. That's a much more language-based skill, even though it is a little bit more in terms of prosody. She actually extends a little bit further beyond when she starts saying that Latrice should receive pre-teaching and new information, particularly new vocabulary, to assist Latrice in becoming familiar with new subjects and associated vocabulary. This woman didn't know vocabulary assessment whatsoever. She didn't know assessment of her ability to learn new vocabulary in any way, shape, or form. She only just sat there and did the auditory processing evaluation. All right, and then lastly, it says the instruction should be short, simple, and repeated or rephrased as necessary, and all new information should be presented in small, well-defined units, okay? So, regardless of what you think about an auditory processing disorder, I would think that you would most likely acknowledge that she's kind of not staying within her lane with these recommendations. They don't have anything to do with what she actually tested, all right? So, might they all help? Yeah, they might help. They might be a great idea for all of those things, but she doesn't have any basis in recommending them, so I would actually recommend that she not do that. Okay, so we're actually heading down to the opening detection just to answer this one. We're asked if there was any documented deficits in central auditory processing abilities, and yes, we do have that one. So that was under item K. All right, so with the LD specialist, one of the things in which she administered was a great oral reading test, which is an oral reading test. So we're on our reading chart here, and everything's going to go under the oral reading category, right, or the row right there in the middle. That middle row of oral reading. Okay, so the question becomes, what type of oral word reading measure are we getting? Okay, with this one, we're getting, if you pick up the test and actually look at it, you would see that we're reading passages. Okay, so this is connected speech. This would be textual word reading accuracy. All right, that's what we're looking at here. So that's one of the things in which we're getting. One little question comes out of that one. Why would we only do textual word reading accuracy and then we not pay attention to sight word reading versus phonological decoding? Both of them, all three of them, are looking at single word reading in that situation. Why would we not look at it from a sight word versus phonological decoding standpoint? All right? The answer to that one is going to be because you're doing too much of a mixture in the midst of connected text. Okay, it's not going to be easily separated into what type of reading or what type of abilities that Latrice is demonstrating. You could do some error analysis, but we don't have access to what those errors are. And it would be difficult even if we did. Okay. So what else are we getting at here? We're getting at comprehension and fluency also. So those are the three things in which we're getting from this test. We're actually getting a reading rate in isolation, although we're just kind of mixing that in with reading fluency here. Okay, that doesn't mean that I wouldn't go back and try to make some comment about rate if it were, excuse me, differential from how we actually found, if we found a discrepancy between the rate and the accuracy, but it seems like the two scores were rather similar. Okay, so she was below average on rate, accuracy, and fluency, but she was actually barely within the normal range for comprehension. I do want to take just a moment to discuss that test score. All right. So if you remember our discussion about the GORT, we talked about how we can actually somewhat overestimate and underestimate comprehension just based upon the nature of the test. The nature of this test, remember, is that it's actually more of a fluency test than it is a comprehension test. So that way, fluency heavily weights the comprehension score. If fluency tends to be really, really low, then comprehension can actually be drugged down as well. Or if fluency tends to be high, then comprehension can actually be artificially inflated upward. Okay? So all that being said, it actually leads me to believe that even though her GORT comprehension score was a 7, which is borderline range, okay, it's very low average. If it would have been a 6, then it would have been below average. But with it being a 7, and it's actually higher than is her fluency scores, I actually think it's probably perhaps, if anything, right, if anything, a little bit of an underestimate of her comprehension abilities. Okay, so remember that fluency drags it, it's like a magnet, it pulls comprehension toward it. So in that situation, if fluency is below, then it's actually a little bit safe to assume that comprehension could actually be, in fact, higher than the scores that were obtained. So I would consider, at this moment, we're going to have some other pieces of information come in, but at this moment, I would consider that the GORT is going to be, the comprehension, in, at least as it's assessed by the GORT, is going to be a relative strength for Latrice. All right, the Title I teacher, we've discussed who this individual is. This individual works in generally low-income schools or schools that have a high proportion of free or reduced lunch, and they work primarily in the areas of literacy and math. So this woman, in Latrice's case, is most likely working in literacy, okay, because she administered a couple different literacy tests to Latrice. All right, the first thing was she administered an adult sight word list, which has been around Order in the Hills, okay? It has about 220 words, they're common words, and then 95 words that are commonly encountered in children's books. Okay, they represent really high frequency words and they're difficult to sound out or to illustrate. Okay, now if I put these words up here, we'd realize that not all of them are that difficult to sound out. So they claim that they're assessing sight words, but I promise you if I put up those 220 words in there, there are some things that can absolutely be sounded out. So they're not doing a great job of separating phonological decoding versus sight word reading with that. All right, the teachers are also kind of encouraged not to allow the student to take forever on sounding out a word. But from my experience with teachers, they're not generally in the habit of doing things that make their kids' test scores suffer. So if they're sitting there sounding it out and they're actually being successful at doing it, I don't think they're going to say, no. Hey, you need to sight word read that one, okay? If you don't get it right, like in half a second, I won't count it wrong. I don't think that's generally the case. Now, obviously, there might be exceptions, okay? So they are single words regardless of whether or not they're nonsense or phonological decoding, but that doesn't really clue us into what it is just because the way in which the stimuli are divided. So I'll put them up here just as the overall, just single word read. We'll put them under sight word and phonological. It's not all that important that we differentiate between the two right now. We're going to have enough information by the end of this where we're going to see kind of what's going on. Right? If you also have something I haven't discussed, if you remember we looked at Latrice's work samples, her school, her classroom samples, and we see that she's actually probably poor at both. She's poor at phonological decoding but relying on sight word reading. So in that situation, if we're going to approach literacy, which I would recommend at some point in time, if we're going to approach literacy, then we would probably address both elements of reading. All right, the Title I teacher also assessed the DIBLs. It's a little bit difficult to discuss what DIBLs is specifically for Latrice because it does jump around a bit, both kind of focused on how old she is or what grade she's in or what level it is that they're trying to assess at. So DIBLs is designed to assess the majority of elementary school age children. It just uses different subtests and different weights in order to do so. All right, so it's called the Dynamic Indicators of Basic Emergent Literacy Skills. And the description that Simicase gave was that it's assessing phonological awareness abilities, phonological decoding abilities, and oral reading fluency. There's also some abilities on there that incorporate sight word reading into it also. So there's just a number of things that are made up in that one. So that's what we're going to look and find with DIBLs. All right, so we incorporate it into phonological awareness, the sight word reading, and then also the phonological decoding. All right, so she was deficient in that category as well, as also she was with the DOSH. But it was earlier in the year, and it is something that the teacher has claimed that she is making progress on. All right, now here's where we get the difficult stuff. Okay, this is where we get the stuff from the psychologist. The psychologist's report's almost always going to be the hardest to interpret. Right, the audiologist report's sometimes hard to interpret, but the thing is you kind of know what the recommendations are because the recommendations are a lot more concrete. The psychologist report, sometimes it's hard to interpret and it's kind of hard to determine what the recommendations are as a result. The psychologist one typically doesn't always end in a diagnosis. At least the one that was supplied by Simicase did not end in a diagnosis. Most of the ones that I've encountered will at least make some general diagnostic statement at the end of it, even if they're not necessarily using a code in order to identify someone. Okay, but there is an awful lot of information which we can get from the psychologist. Part of it's going to come from the intelligence testing which they administer. This was the test which was included for Latrice. I would say it's probably the gold standard for psychological evaluation. But it's also being the gold standard and being that it's existed forever and it's got an awful lot of data behind it. It's outrageously expensive. And the majority of folks that I know who administer it do it in a number of kind of electronically enhanced ways. Either it at least gets scored electronically and reported electronically, and many times it gets administered electronically. So much so to where it kind of idiot-proofs it. So we looked into getting some of these for students, but we figured you would never learn from your mistakes because it makes you stop at your basal, or it makes you stop at your ceiling, and it makes you start at your basal and things like that. Basically, you're just sitting there. You have an iPad. The kid has an iPad, and they have at it, all right? You're more kind of facilitating as opposed to administering in that situation. But that was all a really long way of saying that it's expensive because one, it takes the equipment, but two, it's usually you're getting charged by the actual administration, right? So it's a couple bucks or up to several bucks to actually administer or to score or whatever it may be, right? What we're getting from this one, the first thing we're seeing here, the first thing I have listed is the full scale IQ, which is 87, all right? That's within normal limits, so we have there's no intelligence deficits listed here. But the question becomes, what are we really gonna do with this score, okay? So 87 is not a high score, because remember 85 would be average, the lowest average we could get, 84 would be below average. It's not really a high score, but what are we gonna do with it? Like, what does knowing what an estimate of her intelligence level actually provide us with, okay? And it does become somewhat of a slippery slope, but it actually kind of tells us, right? Kind of tells us what we can expect from Latrice. Okay, if she had an IQ of 115 right here, so a very, very high average IQ, and she were getting language scores in the 70s, well, then that would be somewhat odd. Okay, we would say that that's definitely a language-based skill. It's not an overall cognitive intelligence-based deficit, okay? Now, what we're not saying here is something that we did for a couple decades throughout the 80s and the 90s, is something that was called cognitive referencing. OK, Okay, in this situation, we would take the IQ score, and that would be our criteria. All right, so let's say we have, we'll do easier math than Latrice's. Let's say that she had an intelligence score of 90. Okay, and that would now become like what you would expect all her test scores to be. You would expect it to be 90. Right now, you would sit there and establish some form of criteria for how deficient a score had to be below 90 in order to be classified as a deficit. Right, so let's take a simple one standard deviation one just because it's simpler math, 15 points, okay? So you take 90 minus 15, and she would have to have a score below 75 on whatever performance test it was. So if it was a test of, if it was the Peabody, okay? Or if it was the Woodcock-Johnson, or if it was some subtest on the Gort, or some subtest on whatever self you can think of, okay? So that was the way we did things for quite some time. Actually, before it died out, right about the time I started practicing speech language pathology, right, there was a number of reasons why it was found out. There was a lot of bias that was inherently built in there, and it's actually absolutely not the way in which we do it now. So I'm not saying that's what we're looking at now, but it does help you make decisions, okay? If Latrice's intelligence score was around 77, right, and a lot of her language scores were around 75, that does not include or exclude her from receiving services, okay? That is a piece of the puzzle. It is something that you can consider, and it is something that you can factor in whenever you're deciding whether or not to continue serving her or to not continue serving her, right? I'd say it probably has more of an impact on the continue serving as opposed to initiate serving. A lot of times if we have an individual who has low language scores, for whatever reason, we're going to say, okay, well, they need to be in treatment, right? Until we're proven otherwise, we usually tend to enroll. At least that would be what I think will be most of our philosophies. So what else we got from them? We got the verbal comprehension index, which is just looking at expressive and receptive comprehension of abstract language and vocabulary. The description goes on to say, a child with an average score in verbal comprehension can participate in conversation, understand directions, follow classroom discussion, and explain his ideas as well as other students his age, okay? So I went ahead and just put this one up here without having some big grand reveal so that we can see it. So we have our first little contradiction here. If we look at it, we see it was actually a relative strength, and everywhere that we put it within the expressive and receptive semantics, we actually put it in every single one of our categories, but every single one of our categories previously had a negative in it, now it's got a positive in it. Okay, the question becomes, how are we going to interpret this? When we have a contradiction in results, we have conflicting results with each other. Okay, so this is the question which we have to ask. Are we going to go with our results, or are we going to go with someone else's results? All right, seeing as how both of you know me decently well, I imagine you would not be surprised that I'm going to say we're going to go with my results. And it's not solely based out of pride. For instance, I didn't administer this test, so it's not a pride on my administration or my interpretation. But it's more based on a number of other factors. One is that this score, which we're getting from the WISC, the verbal comprehension, is an index score, okay? Index is another word for composite score. So it's an awful lot of things boiled down into one. There's a ton of abilities in there that wouldn't fit neatly into our little discrete buckets that we have here between expressive semantics, expressive syntax, expressive morphology. They're more global measures, and there's lots of ways when you're thinking about an index score that you can artificially inflate some abilities by doing really well on easier ones if you're struggling on some of the poorer ones, okay? And there is another one here, and it does somewhat boil down to pride, but not in this situation pride in myself, but it's pride in our profession, okay? If we're going to administer tests, then we need to stand by the results, okay? It would be no reason for us to administer any of these things within the area of receptive semantics, for example, if we said that a psychologist report could come along and find findings that would contradict ours and we'd just go with theirs. Okay, in that situation, you don't need to do an evaluation. They've already done one. We could probably complete most of this graphical organizer with tests that we did not administer. Okay, theirs is a composite score, ours is going to be a subtest score. We're getting more specific and more focal, whereas theirs is going to be more broad and more general. Okay, so does this mean I don't incorporate it into it? No, that doesn't mean I don't incorporate it. It just means that I am going to give preeminence to our scores in this situation. Okay, our job is to explain our scores. It's not to explain away all the scores of the other individuals that have administered it. Okay, that's not your job. Your job is to focus on what you did, not necessarily what someone else did. Sorry, I have one last little bit. You might be asking, well, what would I do if it were confirmed everything? Are you trying to just have your cake and eat it too? In that situation, I wouldn't have done an awful lot with anything confirmed it either. Because when you look at this test and when you see the description of this test, you realize that it is somewhat comparing apples to oranges in this situation. So even if it confirmed, I'm not necessarily putting an additional feather in my hat for that. Okay. The next thing we have here is the working memory index score. Now, this is once again from the WISC as well. It does assess both working memory, obviously it assesses focus as well, both of which are going to be rather difficult to separate from attention. So the question we have here is to reveal possible deficits in working memory, not according to the psychology, all right? But if you remember our description from the repeated sentences subtest, which we found as part of our self-administration, it says that she was very laborious in her repeating sentences, which we've stated is heavily reliant upon working memory ability. Okay, so our little extrapolation from the repeating sentences subtest trump these results? No, it doesn't. Okay, this is going to be a more valid, reliable measure of working memory than is ours. But that means I still have that little bit of a nugget in my mind to where I'm going to think about this as I'm working through things. Like, could this be explained by working memory? And if I continuously see a pattern of things that Latrice is having trouble with that could be explained by working memory, then I might come back to this and actually recommend a little bit of additional testing within this. All right, the next index which we have is a processing speed index. This doesn't tell us a ton for our diagnostic purposes, okay? A lot of times it's going to be highly related to many of our other things that we're looking for. It's usually highly related to auditory processing tasks. It sometimes tells us if there's a global deficit going on for an individual, but not all that reliably. But it can be helpful, right? And the reason which it's helpful, not necessarily for treatment targets, but it's really, really helpful when you're thinking about developing a strategy for this individual to succeed within the classroom, right? A lot of our accommodations come from looking at these processing speed type things. The most of the accommodations that most of you are familiar with, like extended time, distraction-free environment, a reader, a lot of those things actually come from this processing speed index, all right? So that's looking at a lot of concentration and both fine motor abilities as well. So having a note taker, other combinations that we see are commonly found as a result of this subtest, okay? So this subtest is where we most of the time go and look a lot of times for our environmental adaptations. So here's the score up here, and I want to talk about it for a moment. So that's within normal limits. We have a processing speed index score of 94. Okay, but there is, before we sit there and actually answer the question from this previous slide, I left it blank up there. So yeah, some of you who are OCD waiting to fill in all the blanks. All right, just get to it. All right, that'll make you wait. Okay. All right, this was a comment that the psychologist made on explaining away some of her poor behavior in this situation. It said that it was found out that Latrice's poor performance on this task was primarily due to impulsivity, not deficiencies in the skills involved. So in that situation, if we go and we read up there at the top that we're looking at concentration and fine motor abilities, all right, and it's also mentioning that we're having some difficulties with impulsivity, this does start to key in me that we may be having some difficulties with that one, and when we talk about were there any documented deficits in attention from previous testing, okay? Most of the time, none of them, not the teacher or anyone else, stated that they had deficits in attention. However, some of these results are starting to lead us to think that that might actually be a problem, okay? So my answer to this one would be a little, right? We have the impulsivity comment, and that's something that we should look at. Now, does this mean that, once again, we're trumping? We don't trump in area of, in cognitive areas. At least that's kind of my rule of thumb. Like, we're not going to overrule the psychologist in terms of working memory, executive function, attention, things like that one. So I'm not going to say, yeah, she might have some attention problems. What am I going to do? I'm going to be mindful of it throughout my assessment process if I haven't done it yet. Okay. I'm also going to be maybe a conversation that I have if we're all sitting in a room at an IEP committee meeting, all right, which very well might happen. Like, if this is a school psychologist who actually works at your school, I would imagine that she's likely to be in the room whenever you guys are working on it. It's an interesting thing. We don't have enough pieces of the puzzle in order to make a definitive statement on what we think about attention. I mean, she's an avatar. I keep her waiting for hours, and then I ask her a question, and she's still cool with it. So having that human interaction would probably key us in a little bit more in a situation. But for now, we would be mindful of it. Once again, another composite, we have perceptual reasoning, but this is looking at nonverbal, which is the important word that we're getting out of this. So this doesn't give us any targets for treatment, okay? But what we can use it for, because it's absolutely not worthless, is that we can make some assumptions, okay? Given all that is entailed whenever we make an assumption, right? We can make an assumption that overall cognition is sufficient for the appropriate language usage. And that's the assumption which we're making in this situation, right? So if she's not having difficulty when we remove the language, then it's probably the language which is at the core of many of her problems, all right? So that's a situation in which we can say it's not just overall global cognitive delay, cognitive handicap in this situation. It does seem to be much more specific to the realm of language, okay? All right, now the school psychologist also gave the Woodcock-Johnson 3. These are tests of achievement. This is not an intelligence test. These are going to be similar to our test in some degree. Some of them are going to assess the exact same constructs in which we assess. Some of them are going to assess the exact same constructs in which we assess in a completely different way, and it's going to be, once again, back to apples and oranges. Okay, one thing that kind of looks familiar for us, we have broad reading. Okay, that's a composite score that looks at reading fluency in both passive comprehension. It includes some other things as well, but for the most part, with her age, this would be where the focus would be on it. In this situation, we have another conflict, okay, because it is actually found to be, the conflict in which we have in this situation was within reading comprehension. Sorry, the text in front of me is rather small. Was in reading comprehension, where we had the GORC comprehension listed as a relative strength and an actual strength, and now we have comprehension showing up as a relative weakness if I disappear out of the way in order for you to see that square, okay? Now, what are we going to do about this conflict? Right? I can't rely on pride in this situation because this wasn't a subtest that we administered. This one came from the LD specialist or the Title I teacher. I'm not sure, actually, the LD specialist, I believe. Okay, so I'm not going to make the argument that we administered it, so we got to stand behind it. That's not what we can do here. All right, in this situation, there's two different professions administered it. So what I'm going to do in this situation is more focus on the nature of the task. The nature of the task is that both of these have their flaws, but the broad reading, the basic broad reading skill assessment is once again a composite score. So we're looking at a lot of different things in that situation. It's not a specific reading comprehension score. So given that, I'm probably not going to let that override our score at this point in time, okay? We're going to add some more evidence in just a moment, but we're not quite there yet, all right? So for the sake of this assignment, though, I'm putting it in all of those categories. So in sight word reading, phonological decoding, and reading comprehension as well. Alright, we get back to an easy one coming from the psychologist. Alright, the spelling, we're looking at sight word reading and spelling, phonological reading and spelling. That's where these would lie. Okay. This is the only written task which I think we're going to do throughout this one. So her score wasn't that low, but it was still low. It was an 82, so the average range 85 to 115 or so will be below the average range in that situation. Alright, now getting even more conflicting information from the school psychologist compared to the results from the Title I teacher or the LD specialist with the GORT. Right, the passage comprehension subtest, which was found to be below the average range for Latrice as well. Okay. All right, it's still not necessarily the most pressing issue here, but if you're concerned or you're curious, you probably need to look at the nature of the test in this situation. All right. When we think about the passage comprehension, and this stuff was readily available online, so this is not something that you cannot do, but I can. You can absolutely look this type of stuff up for everything that you're doing. The subtest measures a student's understanding of written text. Okay, that doesn't really key us into an awful lot. But this is where we start to see how they do that. All right, first they do a series of rebus naming, so they say, like, this picture equals this word, this picture equals this word, this picture equals this word, and then they use nothing but pictures and expect you to read it. Okay, so that's not really what we expect. If I tell Brooks to go read a book, I'm not really expecting him to do that, right? And then after we move beyond that one, you start matching a short phrase to the appropriate picture. So we're using additional context in each one of these situations. We're looking at visual analysis in each one of these. Yeah, you have to read in order to do it, but there's more than just reading. And a lot of the test items actually require you just supply a missing word to sentences and then to paragraphs of increasing complexity. Okay, so suffice to say, this isn't what we would necessarily think of when we say that our individual's having deficits with reading comprehension. All right, I've mentioned several times over that the problem with a lot of our reading comprehension tests is that they focus specifically on literal interpretations of the text. Now that's not what this one is doing. This one's actually making things possibly more complicated than we would expect as in the matter of a couple of reading tasks. Okay, so now what am I going to do if we go back and we look at this one right here where we were. Okay, so in this situation we're looking specifically at our reading comprehension. We have two negatives and a positive. Am I going to change my mind yet? Yeah, I'm going to start to be convinced. Okay? But you know what I'm going to start to be convinced that is that she has more subtle deficits in reading comprehension. And if you have a test that is specific enough and sensitive enough to detect those measures, then she might see some differences. Okay. Now there's going to be like a lot of tests like this that if you're having trouble enrolling a child and the mom really wants services, you're going to say, all right, give them that test and they'll qualify. Don't worry about it. Okay, back in my graduate school days, the PLS was far more popular than it is now. I don't think we necessarily at the time realized how lacking that tool was. And a lot of times we'd administer that one and they do okay. And we say, all right, well, I really think this kid needs some help. Or the daycare workers say, I really think this kid needs some help. Or teacher, or mom, whoever it may be, we say, all right, we'll give him the self. And sure enough, you give him the self and they bomb it. Okay. The self which is more sensitive to subtle deficits than was the PLS. You had to do pretty poorly at the PLS in order to actually qualify in that situation. A school psychologist actually gave word attack. Now this is wrapping it up with something that's also kind of easy for us to interpret. That fits in neatly here with our other results. So we have word attack that's mostly looking at phonological decoding. And that's what we had there, okay? So let's kind of look at all our answers to the open-ended questions. I just wanted to kind of put all of them up there. We talked about some of them as we work our way through, but I wanted to make sure that we're all on the same page whenever we start to work our way through our diagnostic statement, okay? All right, any documented deficits in hearing? Nope. Visual impairments? Nope. All right. Intelligence deficits? No, that's what we got from our psych report, okay? Now, how about working memory? No, we don't really see any deficits from the formal testing of working memory. However, there were a pattern of results which might indicate that we're having some more subtle deficits in working memory. All right. How about possible deficits in short-term memory? Not according to psych once again, but we had difficulties in following directions and in sentence repetition. Both of those are heavily reliant upon memory abilities. I didn't mention that when we were talking about following directions, but obviously if I tell you go do this, 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 and this, you got to remember those three things. You have to keep them in short-term storage. All right? There's no interference task that's associated with that one, so no repeating task. It's just doing those things. So it's going to be much more short-term than it is working. All right, how about any deficits in long-term memory? Not according to psych, all right, but we did have some deficits in language comprehension, in reading comprehension, at least some mixed deficits in that one. And language, reading comprehension, excuse me, is highly reliant upon world knowledge, long-term memory, okay? So that's the type of stuff you might start thinking about here. All right, was there any documented deficits in memory from previous testing? No, working memory and processing speed were within normal limits, so we don't need to answer the follow-up question for that one. All right, any deficits in attention? No, we don't really see that in our testing. But do we have any documented deficits in attention from the other one? We've already had this discussion to a degree, okay? But we had that auditory processing disorder diagnosis up there, which I told you is highly related with attention as well. We also have impulsivity in the processing speed index task. Okay, so both of those might lead us to believe that attention could be at least a minor player in this situation. All right, any word finding deficits? No, not in this situation. We had a receptive score of 66 and expressive score of 64. That was the reason why I chose the EOW-PBT to give and the ROW-PBT to give at the same time. All right, we can make that comparison. Remember, if we see a pattern of expressive being higher than receptive, that's generally indicative of attention problems. If we see a pattern of receptive being higher than expressive, that's generally indicative of word finding problems. We saw neither of those patterns in the current testing. Right, and then we already got to K down here where we're talking about the audiologist report. All right, so now let's try to wrap a pretty little bow around this entire thing. All right, here's the complete oral language graphic organizer. So if you're scoring at home, this is what it's going to look like. If you're more like most people and you're just curious how I'm going to be scoring at home, all right, for your semi-case assignment, that's done as part of the normal prompts. Okay, not going to be doing it all fine-tooth comb. For whenever you're doing this as part of your more formal assignment, then yeah, you are going to have to put these things in their right place. Okay, but like I said, I'll describe that assignment in a later date. Okay, now we talked about making a diagnosis from this. We're going to make a diagnosis from this and from the reading part as well. We always talked about how we need to talk about the patterns of both strengths and weaknesses. Now, it is difficult to come up with a series of strengths from this one. We have no item analysis in order to go by. We're stuck here with just a big pile of tests, all of which have minuses beside them, except for the one test from the WISC, which we said was so broad in its description that we really don't know what she was exhibiting strengths on or not. In this situation, we would have a really hard time coming up with the patterns of strengths and weaknesses. Okay? That's why whenever we were doing our assignment, our self-assignment, I actually had you discuss the item analysis, not of the composite scores, but of the individual subtests. That way we actually get a lot more fine-tuned and understand the skills and abilities which the individual was demonstrating as opposed to these broad descriptions, okay? Broad descriptions are good for getting your foot in the door, they're not good for doing treatment, okay? So I do believe very comfortably in stating, since we see so many negatives up here, that she does have a receptive language disorder, and I do believe that we can comfortably state kind of what it's characterized by as well. Okay, so this is an actual statement which I would have made. I have some notes down there at the bottom or some ways in which you could alter it. But based upon the results of the current oral language evaluation, Latrice qualifies for the following diagnoses: receptive expressive language disorder characterized by deficits in both the production and comprehension of semantic, syntactical, and morphological concepts. Okay. Now, if you want to take away receptive expressive language disorder, you could, and you could put developmental language disorder, or you could put specific language impairment. In both those situations, I think you would be are right and safe in your terminology in order to do it. Right? You'll find pretty early on in your working setting that there are words that you'll choose and some that you'll tend to use more frequently than others. All right. So now we're not done yet. All right. This is not necessarily the final diagnosis in which we'll be writing. Okay. We do need to incorporate the reading element, and that's what we're going to focus on next. All right. So here's the completed written language graphic organizer. And we can see a big pattern of weaknesses as well. I would say, okay, let me kind of phrase how I would say this one. Okay, I'm not necessarily sure that I would go and list comprehension as a strength for her, but I would say that she exhibited variable abilities in regards to comprehension. Okay, and then I'd actually probably go out and explain it. This would not be in my diagnostic statement section, but now we have it here and we're explaining each of these situations. If I were looking at my overall impressions, I might say that she exhibited variable reading comprehension abilities as exhibited by conflicting results on two separate assessment tools administered by two separate professionals, okay? And then you can kind of describe it. You can say, well, McGort, she obtained a score of this. On the Woodcock-Johnson, she obtained a score of this. And you can say it's possibly due to the nature of the task and the differential manner in which these tests assess comprehension. Okay, something along those lines. All right, did you get all that down? Okay. All right, so either way, you're going to be monitoring it. Most likely, you're not specifically going to be working on comprehension anyway, so this is not the way in which you're going to be getting your foot in the door. A lot of times with comprehension, you'll be working on it from a semantic standpoint, you'll be working on it from a phonological awareness standpoint, or you'll be working on it from a phonological decoding, sight word reading standpoint, all the ways in which we can focus on treating literacy, and it's not necessarily that you're going to go directly toward comprehension. Does that mean we're never going to read some stories and answer some questions? Yeah, we'll do that explicitly with some graphic organizers as well, but we're typically not writing as many goals that are directly focused upon comprehension in the first place. Okay, so let's try to wrap our pretty little bow around this one. All right, based upon the results of the current written language evaluation, Latrice qualifies for the following diagnoses. All right, I'll put my best Ron Burgundy here and say dyslexia. All right, now that's the question. Now, we talked about the pattern of dyslexia and whether or not we'd be comfortable using this term. First of all, we have a couple strikes against dyslexia because sometimes it turns people off when we use that term. Remember that I said a lot of times I'll just safely and somewhat cowardly use the term. These symptoms are consistent with a diagnosis of dyslexia in that situation. Well, even in order to use that type of term, we need to understand what the symptoms that are consistent with dyslexia and see if this fits that pattern. All right, so what we see with dyslexia is primary deficits in decoding. Does she have deficits in decoding? Yes, she does. Do those deficits tend to lead to deficits in comprehension? Yes, they do. We're along the same path now. But it tends to be a little bit more literacy specific in that situation. So that's where her oral language is still struggling as well. All right. Her intelligence is within normal limits. Her oral language is not within normal limits. That would be, in this situation, I probably would not give a definitive diagnosis of dyslexia as a result of that. Some people might, okay? Now, if we were trying to kind of do like eggs in a basket type thing, some eggs go in the basket of yes, diagnose dyslexia based upon intelligence was within normal limits, okay? But from my viewpoint, we have enough evidence right here that says this is just an overall oral language type disorder. And we could say that the language, we can have other terms for it. It's basically what I'm getting to. So what I would not do is go ahead and diagnose dyslexia, but what I would be more comfortable with diagnosing is reading disorder. And I do tend to reserve the dyslexia card for more specific situations than that. Now, if I were in a setting in which you needed that diagnosis of dyslexia, then I might take a harder look at it. But how things work practically in my world right now, I don't tend to firmly need that definitive term. So a lot of times I can get by with this more generic term right here of a reading disorder, okay? So it's characterized by deficits in phonological awareness,
textual word reading accuracy, textual word reading fluency, sign word reading accuracy, phonological decoding accuracy, oral reading comprehension, and spelling, okay? And you could also write, instead of reading disorder, that it would be a written language disorder, okay? Now, the last thing that you could kind of do to combine both of these would be to combine the oral and written. If you remember from the very close to the beginning of class, and also within our report writing tips section, we're talking about how we can combine oral and written diagnoses into one as well. So if we're using that language learning disorder, that actually includes the oral language and the literacy component as well. I don't tend to use this one as much because most people aren't necessarily aware that the utilization of this term incorporates both of them. Not to mention, you'd be left with this really, really, really long sentence or two sentences, as I think I have it divided here, which is basically just saying everything that those previous two sentences stated with all the descriptions in which they have. Okay, I do think it flows off the tongue a little bit smoother if you divide it up into two actual distinct diagnoses. All right, the last little bit, okay? We add in other people's diagnoses as well, as long as it's gonna be pertinent to our recommendations, okay? If it were something to do with vision, right, and it's not affecting us, I realize vision can affect us, but I'm talking about like visual acuity or something like that, and it's not affecting whatever it is that we're doing, then in that situation, I'm not going to include every diagnosis that's been offered by every professional. In this situation, we're probably going to concur with the majority of the audiologist recommendations, at least for preferential seating and for amplification. So we make those recommendations. That means we need to incorporate the diagnosis by whom actually diagnosed it, okay? So you wouldn't say based on the result of this evaluation, Latrice exhibits auditory processing disorder. You would say this probably in the background section when you're talking about previous testing. You said that previously Latrice has been diagnosed with an auditory processing disorder, okay? But if you're also going to talk about it here, it needs to re-show its head up, okay? So if you were doing this as three distinct diagnoses, which is how I would recommend it, you'd have the initial one of the oral-based language disorder term which you're using, the written language disorder term which you're using, and then you would have this statement. In addition, Latrice has been previously diagnosed with an auditory processing disorder by an audiologist, comma Ms. Sanchez. All right, that will be what I'll incorporate into this one before we start heading into our results. Okay, now that's going to be the end of this. I don't have a long farewell, so farewell.